Hi, I'm Shashank Bhargav, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. In today's episode, we will talk about the instances of police allegedly obstructing essential services and in many cases beating people for breaking the lockdown. We will also talk about hundreds of migrant workers that are now having to walk back to their villages. But first, we talk about the Garib Kalyan Yojana. Yesterday, in light of the 21-day lockdown that has been put in place due to the spread of the coronavirus, the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman announced a relief package largely aimed at benefiting the workers from the unorganized sector and the urban and rural poor.
Government has been working so that those affected directly, and particularly the poor, the migrant workers, the women, the disadvantaged of the society, since the lockdown commenced, will have to be reached out with tangible help and assistance. It's only 36 hours since the lockdown has been imposed. And therefore now we have come with a package which will immediately take care of the concerns, the welfare concerns of the poor and the suffering workers and those who need immediate help.
This relief package, she said, will be under the Garib Kalyan Yojana and is expected to meet Rs. 1.7 lakh crore. And while making this announcement, she also said that Rs. 50 lakh per person will be provided as medical insurance for paramedics, ASHA workers and doctors. In this segment, we will talk about the highlights of this relief segment. Harish Damodaran, Indian Express's rural affairs editor, talks about to what extent this will actually help the poor.
Yeah, as we know, the objective is basically to compensate people who have lost work opportunities. And these people are the people who are daily wagers or who run, you know, small informal enterprises and basically require money on a daily basis, right? And that opportunity has now been lost, okay? And since they are having to pay that cost for the larger good, obviously they have to be compensated for that, right? Remember that all these people were doing something before the lockdown started, okay? Somebody would have been working on a construction site, or maybe he or she was a head load worker. Somebody may have been running a cycle puncture shop or a small power loom unit. So all these people are today out of business, and there is obviously a cost of sitting at home as far as they are concerned. So therefore, one must look at that context. So now the issue is, how effective is this package, whatever, 1,70,000 crore package, in terms of meeting the objective of, you know, compensating the people who are bearing the brunt of the current lockdowns? I would say that the most effective component in the package has been doubling the grain entitlement.
This measure was that 80 crore poor, or roughly two-thirds of population, would get 5 kg rice or wheat free for the next 3 months. This will be over and above the 5 kg they already get. Additionally, they will also get 1 kg of their preferred pulse.
See, a typical poor household consumes around 50 kg of rice or wheat every month. So if you take, say, a family of five, so the current entitlement is basically 5 kg per person. So if we were to look at a family of five, it means 25 kg. The remaining 25 kg, this household now has to buy from the market. Okay. Now it doesn't have the money. So the government is saying that we will give you another 5 kg per person free. So roughly it means that, you know, a poor household today doesn't have to buy rice or wheat. And we are talking of about something like 80 crore people, you know, and then which is about two-thirds of the population. And same thing, they're also being given 1 kg of pulses. So assuming this will be implemented properly, we are ensuring that these people are at least getting their dal and roti. So I would say that this has been a great move, if you were to ask me. Plus also the fact that economically also it makes sense. By offering these grains free of cost, actually the Food Corporation of India is saving a lot on just the cost of maintaining these reserves. You know, so you're getting rid of surplus stocks, because the surplus stocks also have an inventory carrying cost. You pay interest, you pay storage and all these kind of things. So by offloading this, frankly, I think this is the only worthwhile element in this package.
Apart from this, it was also announced that Ujjwala beneficiaries would get free cooking gas, essentially LPG cylinders, in next 3 months, and that there would be an increase in MNREGA wage from 182 rupees a day to 202 a day.
Let us first examine MT NREGA. Fine, the wage rate has been increased. But the fact is, there are no MT NREGA works at all happening, right? So again, even if these people want to do MT NREGA work, they cannot do it because again, you need to maintain social distancing and all these things. So this is purely theoretical. This has no meaning. So I would say that the MT NREGA increase in wages is not going to make any difference. When there is no work, there's no point in saying that your wages are going to go up or your salary is going to go up, right? I mean, salary is only for work done. No work, no salary. These people are not government employees, right? So here we are talking of the working class. Even gas cylinders being given free of cost, I don't think it will make much of a difference beyond a point, you know, because how much of gas cylinders are you going to buy? Okay, it's possible that the next cylinder which will come will be given free of cost. Yes, it will again save them the cost of spending money. Just like we have spoken of the grains, right? I'm giving you an extra 5 kg grain, you know, free of cost. So I would say that that is the thing. But where I'm most disappointed is the cash transfers, you know. We should understand today that the main problem that all poor households today are facing is a crisis of liquidity, okay? They want to work, but they cannot work, right? And they were working before, but they cannot work today. So they desperately need cash. And this is not the case only with poor households, even with businesses, you know. Today, I cannot sell. If I'm running a store which is employing, say, 2 people, right? I'm not able to sell today. So therefore, I cannot keep those 2 employees, you know. I need to pay salaries, right? I cannot do it. So any business, you know, any business or any household. So these people needed cash. And there I'm really disappointed because definitely I think there was a case to make more cash transfers. Whereas what has been announced is nothing much.
What was announced is that 8.69 crore farmers would be given 2,000 rupees immediately through direct cash transfer under the existing PM Kisan Yojana.
See, like for example, PM Kisan. So this first installment was anyway going to be made. We know that PM Kisan basically is 6,000 rupees in 3 installments of 2,000 rupees each. And these installments anyway come once in 4 months. And this 2,000 rupees was anyway due. So there's no additionality. It would have made sense instead that I front load all these transfers, you know, maybe release 6,000 rupees straight away. That would have made a lot of differences. In the next few days, farmers will be harvesting their crop. Okay. And at the same time, there is no labor available today. So the cost of labor is going to increase. So farmers need that extra money. So it would have made a lot of difference if you had released this PM Kisan, you know, all the installments maybe upfront, and then think about what to spend later. See, today, as I'm saying, today the main crisis is I need money today, you know. It is to survive for the next 15 days. We are not looking at the long run or something. In the long run, we are all dead. But now the problem is, even in the short run, if I'm a poor person, I'm risking starvation even in the short run. So the focus of policy is on the very short run, next 10, 15 days. How do people who require their daily means of livelihood, how are they going to manage? I think there's been something on the Jandhan, this thing for about 20 crore people, about 500 rupees per month, which again is, you know, very small. It's like administering homeopathic doses to a person who needs immediate treatment, you know. So I would say that definitely it's lacking on that. Personally, I would have preferred, you know, a cash transfer straight away, you know, of 10,000 rupees to all poor households straight away, you know. And that, along with this, whatever, doubling of grain entitlement, I think that would have been the perfect package. And maybe this is something that should have been done straight away.
Next, we talk about the police. Since the 21-day countrywide lockdown was announced on Tuesday, there have been several reports of the police stopping those providing essential services, from vegetable and meat shop owners to even doctors and paramedics. There have also been reports of the police beating people with lathis for allegedly not following the lockdown. A number of videos of them doing it have also emerged online. In this segment, we talk to Deepti Mantiwari, who reports on government agencies and corruption for the Indian Express, about these incidents and the structural problems that contribute to it.
There have been multiple reports from across the country, not just in Delhi or metro cities, but across the country, where police, after announcement made by Prime Minister Narendra Modi of a 21-day lockdown, just cracked down on almost everybody who was walking down the road or selling vegetables or fruits. Just a total random crackdown on people just to put them off the roads. Probably instructions were not very clear from the top brass to the lower constabulary, which actually implements this lockdown on the ground. And that is why this was happening. I mean, even though essentials such as food items, vegetables, fruits, meat shops, or e-commerce delivery personnel, milk booths, all of these have been exempted from the prohibition. And this was something that even the Prime Minister mentioned in his speech. But perhaps the police top brass could not communicate this very clearly to the lower constabulary, and because of which what we saw is across the country, police was going and downing shutters on meat shops and vegetable vendors and asking them to shut shop till April 15. There were places where e-commerce delivery boys were beaten up by the police for riding their bikes and going to deliver somewhere. There were even doctors and paramedics who were not allowed to cross the state border. For example, somebody coming from Gurgaon or Noida to Delhi, they were not allowed, and doctors had a tough time convincing the police that they should be allowed to go because they are the ones who are treating patients who have tested positive for coronavirus. So it has been a total mayhem in the past couple of days. Let's hope that the police is able to get its act together and streamline things.
You recently spoke to the police commissioner of Delhi. What did he have to say about these instances?
Well, he was very candid, and he admitted that there have been slip-ups on part of the police and there has been some sort of a communication issue, and that the police has been very harsh on the first day implementing the lockdown. He was suggesting that perhaps the focus on the first day was to first ensure that there is complete lockdown and people stay indoors, and that is why police went overboard and they beat up people, which should not have happened. And he also said that, you know, even the police was not very clear about what made essential items actually. What are essential items and what are essential services? And so there were issues of delivery boys being beaten up and vegetable vendors being asked to go home. He said that these things are being streamlined. Even the police top brass is slowly getting to know, okay, this thing is also an essential item. Okay, this thing is also an essential item. So slowly and steadily, they're basically passing on these instructions to the lower constabulary. In fact, even today, a new order has been issued by the Delhi police, which has been circulated to all the DCPs and further to the lower constabulary, where each and every e-commerce platform has been mentioned in that order. That, okay, Zomato is to be allowed, Swiggy is to be allowed, Amazon, Flipkart, Grofers, everything is to be allowed, because the lower constabulary does not understand, does not know what is to be stopped and what is. So everything is now being fleshed out. Each and every name is being told to them so that they understand. Similarly, newspapers are not being delivered at most places in metro cities. Now, the issue there is that while Prime Minister has said that print media and electronic media are part of essential services, but barring journalists, the vendors do not have identity cards. So police has been saying that without identity cards, how do we know who is a vendor, who is not? So that thing is being streamlined. Media houses have been asked to issue identity cards to these vendors so that their passes can be made. This is what the commissioner was also saying, that we are trying to implement the lockdown as effectively as possible without disrupting essential services. In fact, there have been reports of trucks being held up at interstate borders because of various reasons which police is known to do. They check papers, documents are not proper, you cannot go. So now instructions have been passed that you're not supposed to check documents. You're supposed to just see whether the truck is carrying essential goods or not. If it is carrying food items, if it is carrying medicines, if it is carrying essential supplies, it has to be allowed to go without asking any questions. Now, all depends upon how well-oiled the system can be and whether we also see instances of corruption, which happens, which almost every police force in this country is very famous for.
I was wondering how much of this is sort of, a structural problem, you know, because we've seen, you know, these instances in the past where the police, you know, tries to enforce something, you know, sometimes even the law does not demand. Like we're seeing them beat people with lathis. I mean, that is obviously not acceptable. So how much of that is the structural problem within the police system?
Look, there are two things in this. First is, this is an unprecedented measure, which has been taken by an announcement at 8 p.m. And almost everybody has come to know about this at that time. So not only the people get struck with panic, but even the system panics, okay, because they don't do this every day. So this creates a problem even for the system, the people who enforce these things, okay. Now, second thing is that although we have a National Disaster Management Act and it has broad guidelines of what to do during disasters, there have been no standard operating procedure for this kind of a lockdown that has not been laid down as yet, because of which, you know, you have to take on the spot decisions. And when that happens, then it is up to every policeman who is on the ground. So that is basically the structural issue, where you don't have laid down standard operating procedures for something of this kind. There are standard operating procedures for various disasters, but for a nationwide lockdown, how do you manage things? How do you operate at interstate borders? This is something where decisions are being taken on a day-to-day basis. And as we see, the Home Ministry every day issues fresh orders. Okay, now this has to be done. Now this has to be done. After issuing broad guidelines for this lockdown, the next day the Home Ministry had to issue a fresh addendum of things which were also included in the essential items. And a telling example of how this is being happening on the ground is that the Home Ministry, even though petrol pumps are open and everyone knows that people will be cooking at home, the Home Ministry had to specifically mention that LPG cylinders have to be allowed. Now, see, that's the whole issue, that the person on the ground is unable to decide for himself that LPG is an essential good. So it has to be allowed. So everything is now being specifically mentioned because that person says, I don't have orders. I cannot allow it. I don't care whether people cook at home or they eat grass. I don't care. So these are some of the structural problems, because the lower constabulary is not supposed to use its mind. It is supposed to follow orders. This is how the police system is structured in our country. So everything has to be spelled out to them. And we all know that corruption is a huge, huge problem in the police system. So almost every opportunity that the lower constabulary or any other person on the ground who has been at this point in time given immense powers to, you know, obstruct anyone's movement is going to use for corruption. So that is something that the police top brass will have to be very, very careful about. And we'll have to ensure that this does not happen, because otherwise the entire essential supply chain is going to be massively disrupted, and food prices, prices of other items is going to skyrocket, because that corruption money is going to be adjusted in the prices of these items.
And in the end, we talk about the hundreds of laborers who have been devoid of work due to the 21-day lockdown. Many such workers who rely on daily wages have now been forced to leave cities. But with no rail and interstate buses available, many have had to walk back to their villages hundreds of kilometers away. Ananya Tiwari, a correspondent from Delhi, spoke to some of these workers in the capital who were going back.
So I was driving along the NH24, and there were these groups of migrants in groups of 3 to 4, and they were just walking on the road, on the flyover. So I just pulled up, and there was this one migrant. His name is Umesh Kumar, and he is 28 years old. He was with a few other people, and he had been walking from Kirti Nagar in West Delhi, which is near Mayapuri. And he was going towards Lal Kuan in Ghaziabad, which is around 40 kilometers. It's like cutting the city from west to east. So he said that there was no food, there was no water, all hotels are closed, and we haven't taken a bath in 8 days, and we stink. And there is no water in tanks, there are no provisions. They were a group of 3 to 4 people, And he said that we left in the morning and we've been walking since. I was talking to them at around 1 p.m. and they had been walking since. So for the past 2 days, even getting food was getting difficult. They didn't have food. They couldn't buy vegetables even because they don't have the money. And there was Antresh, who's 21. And he's also a mazdoor, a laborer. And he was walking with a group of people again from Najafgarh, from Dharampuri, Najafgarh. And he was going to Moradabad in UP, which is literally 200 kilometers or something away. More than 200 kilometers away. And he was just walking on the road. And I asked him, so when did you last eat? So he said, I ate last night, but we all left at 3 a.m. And they had been walking since, like the entire day, probably 12 hours. And he said that since March 22nd, there has been no work for them. And there's nothing for them to do there.
Similar was the case of migrant laborers from Rajasthan that work in Gujarat. Hundreds of them have had to go back to their villages. Our Rajasthan correspondent Deep Mukherjee talks about one such worker he spoke to.
So I spoke to several laborers. For example, one of them, Gautam Lal Meena, he's a resident of Pratapgarh in Rajasthan district. I spoke with him yesterday night and he had started on Tuesday morning. And I spoke to him today morning as well, and he's yet to reach Pratapgarh. And the distance is around 700 kilometers. He works in Borivali as a tile fitter. So from Mumbai to Pratapgarh, it's very tough for him to cover that distance and without any proper means of transport. So these laborers, many of them have walked all night, have even braved the police, who they say have been driving them off at many places. But they didn't have any option except simply just walk along the highway. So this guy, Gautam Lal Meena, he said that at places, police stopped them. So they pleaded to the police that you can take us to jail if you want, because at least we would have some food to eat. They didn't have any transport, and it was only after they reached Surat. From Mumbai Gujarat border to Surat, they walked the entire distance, and after reaching Surat, finally the Gujarat government authorities, they arranged for a transport for them. Today morning, I once again got a call from him. He had reached Banswara, but then the rest of the distance, which was at least 80-90 kilometers long till his village, he couldn't find any means of transport to go there. So, and these migrant workers, they don't have much money. The money they had was also spent on taking hitching rides and taking lifts from truck drivers.
I was wondering, once they reach the state, once they reach their state or going to their villages, is there anything that the government or the health officials are doing to help them?
Yes. So the Rajasthan government has posted teams in the border districts of Banswara, Udaipur, Pratapgarh. So what happened, I spoke with the chief medical and health officer of Banswara district yesterday. He told me that within one day, more than 4,500 migrant laborers have arrived at Rajasthan. So these health teams, they are screening each of the people. If somebody have symptoms of any kind of cold or fever, they are being taken to the hospital. Otherwise, generally, every such person who is returning from another state are advised to stay at self-imposed home quarantine for 14 days. And the Rajasthan government have also arranged for buses in some places. The Rajasthan State Road Transport Corporation buses, which are helping them to reach their villages or ferrying them to the interior from the borders. But even now, the arrangement, what I understood from speaking with the laborers, is not adequate, as this person, Gautam Lal Meena himself, said. So even after reaching Rajasthan, they don't have any means to go to their villages. So it's a huge exercise that is currently going on in the state border districts. And anytime soon, it doesn't seem like problems for them will be over. Because the fact is that even after reaching their villages, so these are migrant workers. They mostly work out of state, and now they're out of work. They don't have work anymore. They don't have any means to earn their livelihood, and they have all their families. So it is not clear how they would be managed to sustain throughout this period of lockdown as of yet.
You were listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show, as always, was edited and mixed by our producer, Joshua Thomas. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can also tweet us at Express Audio and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.